Praise God, dear heart. Thank you for joining me again today on the Call-In Deliverance Sessions. I am your host, Evangelist King. Now remember, dear heart, I only make myself available for Call-In Deliverance Sessions on Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Thursdays at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call our Deliverance Conference line number 712-775-7031, and you enter SS code 335950. International, be sure to go to my website at howshalom.org/deliverance to find instructions on how you also can request a deliverance session. Now remember, dear heart, all sessions, they are public, they are recorded and shared on all our programs. Praise God. So I see Alicia has returned, so let me unmute you. Okay, Alicia. Now, are you Martina's aunt?
Yes, I am.
Okay, I have to, but I saw your name. I think that's Martina's aunt. So Martina gave you my message.
Yes, she did.
Okay, all right. So that means that the enemy entered back into the house. Darkness found a space, and because of your disobedience, that was the space. Now, what was the specific instruction that God gave to you to so that you can maintain your deliverance? There was a specific instruction that he had given you. And I want you to say it.
My instruction was to stop talking and listening to, you know, things. You know, because my hearing is, you know, my ears are listening. Well, mm-hmm. I actually called to tell you that me and Martina had spoke to each other. Wednesday, I think that was Monday or Tuesday. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I was calling because I actually had a testimony.
Mm-hmm.
We actually prayed. She did a deliverance for me as well. And mm-hmm. me and Martina prayed over the phone together, and I asked the Holy Spirit to speak to me and to come into me, in which it did. And mm-hmm. I was speaking in the language that I did not know, you know, I wasn't aware, mm-hmm. but I could feel the Lord's presence in
mm-hmm.
me.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually feel better. I'm just trying to, you know, so I can help somebody else, you know. And I actually feel better than what I was feeling, you know, because mm-hmm. I was having this anger and all that stuff. That's actually gone. But my main thing now, I'm trying my hardest, is for the enemy to stop. Every time I turn around, that person is there. You understand what I'm saying? I don't give mm-hmm. nobody no where I'm going, how what time I'm going. I've been trying to, because I know I ain't supposed to be around this person. And they keep popping up in places, you know, when I got to go get my mm-hmm. children, asking me, do I need a ride for this, and do I need this, and no, I don't. But they just keep on showing up, and I don't want to be disobedient, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me get that. You are omitting something.
Okay.
Now, that was a very important instruction that he had given you, the most important instruction that he had given you.
Mm-hmm.
He told you mm-hmm. that you must be willing, that willingness has to come from the heart, that you must be yes. willing to give up that relationship.
Yes, ma'am.
Did you that night sleep in the same bed with that man?
No, I didn't. That's what Martina was telling me. I did not sleep with that man at all. He hadn't even been back to my house. That was the thing mm-hmm. about it. I mean, I could have dreamed it and not remembered it, but I did not sleep. He didn't need to come back to my house that night, or the night after that, or the night, because I didn't let him come back.
Okay, so in your heart, Alicia, did you give mm-hmm. him up completely? In your heart, completely. You couldn't hold on for just a tiny bit.
I probably probably not completely, I'm being honest. Probably not completely.
Yeah.
I probably had a little bitty tiny, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I'm being honest, you know.
Right. You have to be. If you want to be totally free, You must be honest.
I just had probably just the tap, but that was enough probably before let the so the enemy did get back in because it's
that's how
you
got in. How I know, Alicia, that was a tiny because I felt it. But God is so gracious and He's so good in spite of. You know, in the scripture that there was a young man that was afflicted with this disease, and I believe it was some type of sexual disease. And the scripture say he had four friends, and his four friends looked at his condition, had compassion on him, and they heard about Jesus. So it was his four friends that took that young man, and his four friends had faith that Jesus would heal him. So when they found the house that Jesus was to, there were so many people there, they couldn't get in the front door. These men's faith in God was so strong that they took the man and went on top of the roof of the house and began to tear up the roof and then lower the man down into the house. Now, it had to be the Holy Spirit who even let them know the precise position where Jesus was in the house. So it was their faith. Their faith for him to be healed, delivered, and saved. So the scripture said when they put this man down, Jesus looked, and the scripture said, did not say that Jesus saw the man faith. And because of their faith, Jesus forgiven that man, he healed that man, and he delivered that man. And that's what he did to you, because when I was ministering God's word to you, the Holy Spirit let me feel that you still was holding on to that relationship in your heart. Just a tiny bit. You wasn't willing to completely from the heart give it up. And all Satan needs is just a tiny space. And because that space was there, darkness came back in. And that's the reason why that you ended up reacting the way that you react, because it's those spirits that got back into the house. And what those spirits, Alicia, want to do, as I don't know if Martina told you this or not, but I told Martina what these spirits want to do, and I know by the Lord told me, is that, see, the spirit of anger is murder. It's murder. Spirit of anger and hate is murder. And what this spirit wanted to do, the spirit of anger, which is murder, wanted to overpower you, and it wants to kill one of your children through and by using your hand.
Oh my God, no.
And you wouldn't know a thing about it until after it's over with, and you would see your child dead, and people would tell you that, Alicia, you killed him. You said, no, I didn't. Now, when I'm bringing this up to Martina, she mentioned something that happened to you in times past of this very same spirit that took hold of you, but the person that it wanted to kill was your live-in lover. If when you came to yourself, you did not know that you almost killed him, and Martina said that they told you, and you said, no. Well, that same spirit wants to kill your child so that when you come through, it wants to destroy you because you wouldn't be able to live with yourself and knowing that you kill your child in the spirit of suicide, which works with murder, would cause you to even kill yourself because you could not live with the fact, truth that you had killed your child. So that's why I told my team to tell you to call. And you have to be willing to give up that relationship. Now the Lord said when the man come around and say, you know, it doesn't mean that you have to get totally away from him, you know, because you two have something in common, which is your children. You cannot prevent him from seeing his children because they are his children. Mm-hmm. Okay, and Lord said it's okay for him to ask, you know, is there anything you want me to do, because they are his children. Anything related to his children, the Lord said, it's okay for you to receive his help. But when it's things related to you, he wants to do things for you, that's where you draw the line.
Okay.
But where God wants you to give up this relationship is from the heart. Mm-hmm. From the heart. Because it's not a healthy relationship. He's not your husband. You are not his wife.
Right.
You see? Mm-hmm. In the same way that you needed Jesus Christ and deliverance, he also needed to submit his life to the Lord Jesus and get mm-hmm. delivered. So again, the Lord said, if he coming to you and asking you if anything he need to do in pertaining to his children, that is his right because they are his children and that is their father. It's okay for him to do. But when it's come down for you, that's a totally different situation.
Okay. What if he's not a biological father, though? What if he like their stepfather? And then
if he had been with them, I had a stepfather. If he had been with them for so many years and they look on him as a father, they're still mm-hmm. the same. In the children's eyesight, that is their father. Just like with my stepfather, he wasn't my biological father, but he was my father because I was raised with him. You know, I raised with him and I loved him and I looked at him as a father.
Okay.
But again, you know, as long as he ain't trying to, you know, do things for you, because if you start accepting him doing things for you, Satan gradually will be pulling you back into that relationship. Okay. That's where you have to draw that line. And also, you know, whenever he wants to do things for his children, he comes to the house, you say, just stay right out here. You don't let him in the house. You let your children, you stand to the door and let your children talk to him and you watch, you know. But as for you, you know, let him come into your house where he's alone with you and you're alone with him, that's temptation.
Okay.
That is temptation. So Alicia, have you asked the Lord to forgive you for your carelessness?
Yes, I did.
Amen. Amen. Because we sometimes can be very careless. That's why mm-hmm. I stress very importantly to people, when God gives you specific instructions, they are for your good.
Right.
It closed the door off from the enemy. But when we disobey God, that mm-hmm. opens the door for the enemy to attack us. So we must be obedient. And another thing I want to point out, not just to you, Alicia, but to all of those who may be listening now or listen later over archive, when the Lord revealed to me things, it's not mm-hmm. me, it's him. So don't believe that lying devil in telling you Evangelist King told you. Evangelist King told you. Evangelist King haven't told you nothing. It's the Lord who tells her. If the Lord doesn't tell me, then I won't say nothing to you.
Right.
See, that's the only way that we're going to receive from God is by hearing God through his chosen servant. Lord said, mm-hmm. when you reject his chosen servant, you have rejected him. So it's not Evangelist King, it's God. Don't look at me. You see Jesus through me. It's Jesus through me who is ministering to all of you. It's only Jesus through me because it's his love. It's not my love. Love is not in me. Jesus is love. But when Jesus is in us, we are love. We full of love and compassion. So mm-hmm. you need to hear Jesus. As I speak, you listening, you hear Jesus. That's how I got my deliverance, because when the Lord used a woman of God, I heard Jesus. And I saw mm-hmm. Jesus. Now we're talking to Jesus. Jesus was talking to me. Even though it was the woman's body, it was her voice, but I saw Jesus and I heard Jesus using her vessel and communicating with me. And that's what we must do. That's what you all must do. That way you will receive from the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. So, Alicia,
mm-hmm.
now what I'm going to do, I'm going to pray for you again and I'm going to speak a Holy Ghost fire cleansing. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But before I do, the Lord want me to ask you, how are your children? Is your son home yet?
No, my son, he'll be here November 28th.
Oh, November he'll be here.
Yes.
So your other children that is underage,
mm-hmm.
how is their actions and their reactions after that prayer, even to up to now?
My 9-year-old daughter, she's been kind of getting like she want to, you know, I have to tell her 2 or 3 times to do something, and she act like she want to, you know, she want to say something, but she ain't got the courage. You know, she want to, you know what I'm saying? She want to say something, but she ain't got the you know, okay. I can see it in him. He wants to disobey me.
Okay. Now, you have to realize, like I told your niece, Martina, since you are your children's spiritual covering, whenever you open the door, allow the enemy into you, that same enemy also goes into your children who are underage because they are under your covering. Okay? So that defiant spirit in her is the same defiant spirit in you that got you to defy God. But once God cast that spirit out of you, then once again you have legal right to lay hands on your children and command every spirit to loose her and let her go now. In Jesus' name. And you stay under the covering of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Stay under his protection by continuing to be in obedience to him in every area of your life. Okay? And also, you know, you have to watch all relationships. All relationships that does not, that conversation does not draw you to the Lord Jesus Christ. You must cut your hearing off in such relationships. Okay? All right. So I'm going to pray now. So, Father, in Jesus' name again, thank you for this opportunity to minister your love and grace and mercy to your daughter, Alicia. Father, I thank you. Father, you already knew. You have already forgiven her. Before that act was even committed, you had forgiven her. And I thank you, Father, that also Alicia has forgiven herself. And as always, Father, I thank you that every plan and purpose, ideal that you have ordained to take place in her life and bring an only glory to your son, Jesus Christ, it shall be fulfilled in, through, and by her. I thank you, Father, that Alicia and her entire family, they all shall live and not die to proclaim the good news of their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we just praise you and we thank you. We thank you, Father. And I take authority again. There was doors that was opened during that brief period of disobedience. It opened doors that you're not pleased that it was open. I take my authority in Jesus' name and I close shut and close every door and seal it with the blood of Jesus. Those doors will never, ever be opened again in Jesus' mighty name. And there was doors that was closed, that was your will to be open. I also take my thoughts in Jesus' name, and I open every door that is pleasing in your eyesight in Jesus' mighty name. I ask you to continue to give Alicia wisdom, knowledge, and understanding of who she is in your son, Jesus, also who Jesus is in her. Keep her by your spirit, Father. Keep her, Father. Keep her, Father. And I thank you, Father, that you never lose her. You never let her go. And I pray that she never lose you and never let you go, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. So right now, in Jesus' name, I take authority. And I command every unclean spirit, I command you in Jesus' name to come to attention, pat all your nose, and for you all to get out of God's house. You get out. You get out of her mind. You come out of her mind. You come out of her will. You come out of her emotions. And you come out of her body. In Jesus' name, for the blood of Jesus commands and commanded you to loose her. Loose her and let her go now in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost, once again, I call upon you to do your amazing cleansing work. Burned by your mighty fire, just ransack Alicia's mind. Just ransack her mind by your burn all manner of spirits in her mind that exalts themselves and lift themselves against God's knowledge, and Holy Spirit, set them all ablaze. Set them ablaze, Holy Ghost. Burn, Holy Ghost. Burn every spirit that is not of you under the sound of my voice and continue to set them all ablaze. Ransack her mind. Purify her mind. Wash and rinse and baptize her mind in and with the blood of Jesus. Holy Ghost, fire, ransack her will. Burn, Holy Ghost, burn every spirit that got hold of her will that exalts and lifts itself against God's knowledge, and you set them all ablaze. Set them ablaze, Holy Ghost. That's ramshackle will. Purify, wash, and rinse, and baptize her will in and with the blood of Jesus in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost fire, continue to consume darkness that even got hold of her emotion. Burn every spirit in her emotion that exalts and lifts itself against God's knowledge and sets them all ablaze. Set them ablaze, Holy Ghost fire. Burn, Holy Ghost fire. Burn every spirit in her body that don't feel like you. They don't sound like you. They don't react like you, move or talk like you. Set them all ablaze in Jesus' name. Ransack her emotions by your mighty fire in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Ghost, continue to even purge her body. Set ablaze every spirit that jumped into her body and uses her body. Set them all ablaze. Burn every spirit that exalts itself and lifts itself against God's knowledge in her body and set them all ablaze. Holy Ghost, fire, burn, burn, burn in her eyes, her nose, her nostrils, in the mouth, in her ears. Holy Ghost, fire, just ramshack her ears in Jesus' name. Burn even in her hearing, up and down her throat, in her belly, her hands and her legs, her arms, her feet, from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Just continue to just rumble and ramshack her body by your mighty fire. Just let your fire just purge her body. Just rinse and wash her body. Baptize her body in and with the blood of Jesus. Even in the spirit realm, relationships that was reattached, in Jesus' name, I detach her from all those relationships because the blood of Jesus detached her. The blood of Jesus destroys all ungodly covenants and contracts and connections and relationships. The blood of Jesus separates her, disconnects her from every spirit that's not of him. Even in the natural realm, the blood of Jesus dissolves and disconnects and destroys relationships that he did not build. He destroyed every relationship that is not of him. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, Alicia, once again, in Jesus' mighty name, you be totally, totally free. Totally free in your mind. You be totally free in your mind. You be free in your mind. You be free in your will. You be free in your emotions. You'll be free in your dreams, in your vision, in your business, in your affairs, and you'll be totally free in your body to serve and worship the Lord in spirit and truth. In him only will you serve this day forth, in Jesus' mighty name. Father, we thank you, as always, for filling your daughter with your spirit, filling every void and vacant space throughout her being, with your spirit, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. And Holy Ghost, go and ransack her house again. Just clean and purify her house by your mighty fire. Destroy all manner of darkness that may have come back when those doors were open. Locate all their dark hiding places and destroy by your mighty fire. Destroy darkness that is hiding and lurking in every corner, crack, and crevice of her house. Burn, Holy Ghost fire, around under every bed. Burn, Holy Ghost, don't leave no area untouched in Jesus' name. Even outside the house, underground, in the water, don't matter where, destroy by your mighty fire in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for even touching her children once again in Jesus' mighty name. Glory to your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen, Alicia. It's done in Jesus' name.
Okay, thank you.
Now, you stay submitted to God.
Okay.
Because every time one gets delivered and they allow the enemy back into the house, each time, that's a danger, because what I'm finding, what's going to happen eventually when you keep being disobedient, what's going to happen, you never ever again will be willing to be delivered, because you feel like, I'm already delivered. I don't need to be delivered. And that's mm-hmm. a dangerous state to get in.
Okay.
That's the worst. I have come to see that's the worst that happens.
Mm-hmm.
The worst is you never again you will have that willingness, that humbleness and that willingness to be delivered.
Okay.
That means eventually, when you get in a state like that, eventually you will have a scripture called a reprobated mind. And you find yourself doing things that you don't even desire to do or you didn't think you would ever do. That's because you've been turned over to that reprobated mind. So it's dangerous. It's dangerous. We need to stay in obedience to God. Okay?
Yes.
Praise God. So what was you experiencing as I was praying for you? Mention five prayers.
I was experiencing, I could feel, you know, like being grievous again, body and stuff. Afterwards, I feel good. It makes you feel good afterwards, you know. I feel free.
Amen. You are free. That's the goodness of God. God is gracious. He's good.
Because
God already knew what was going to happen. You know, remind me of a time where my step-grandfather, who used to be a witch doctor, and older age, he got real sick. And my grandmother told me that he told her that he asked God to heal him. God said, I will heal you, but you won't let it stay. And my grandmother said that he said, yes, I will. I'll let it stay. God healed him. But God knew he wasn't going to let it stay. But God healed him. So the first couple of months, he was doing great. He was getting, I mean, so much better. Had his health, his strength, brilliant light. He was just great. And then Satan sent a young person to him and reminded him what he used to do for Satan. The young person wanted to go see another witch doctor in another state. He got in the car, he took him. And when he did, all that sickness came back on him, and he ended up dying.
Oh.
That's why we better obey the Lord. We better obey the Lord. Just continue to stay submitted to Him. Okay?
Yes.
Praise God. So you go, and you and Martina encourage and help one another in Christ. And make sure your two conversation always is about Jesus Christ. That's what y'all conversation is. The enemy may try to turn the conversation, talk about something else. You may need to stop Martina. Martina may need to stop you. Matter of fact, the Lord said, you tell each other now. Now, we're starting to talk about the Lord here, Martina. But if you end up switching, changing the conversation to talk about other things, I'm going to stop you. And if I end up switching the conversation to talk about everything else, I want you to stop me.
Okay.
We're going to be made accountable one to another. That's what the Lord said.
Okay.
And that even talking about conversation about your family members, you know, especially those who are not serving the Lord. You know, the Lord told us to pray for them, not talk about them, but pray for them.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Praise God. Don't forget to, once again, I want you to do it. Lord, I want you to do it. You pray for your child. You got to learn how to do this. They are your children. Just like Martina had to learn to pray for hers, and you got to learn to pray for yours. Okay?
Okay. Yes,
remember, it's the Holy Spirit who's with you. He's your teacher. He shows you. He'll tell you. He's there. That's right. Amen. All right, Alicia, stay blessed, okay?
Okay, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Praise God. Praise God. Okay. All right, dear Lord, I'm going to bring on Dee. Dee and Alicia called yesterday. But for some reason, they hung up, and they never called back, so I had ended my last session. And once I end my last session, I don't see no more callers. I don't hang on. I take and hang up, end the session for that day. So I'm going to bring in D, and then I will bring in Diana. So you others, you have to hang up. You make sure you call back before I end my last session, okay? So I'm going to unmute D. Okay, Dee. How you doing?
I am blessed. How are you?
I'm fine.
Amen.
What's going on?
I just wanted to follow up with you, and I guess give a brief testimony more so than to receive any type of prayer.
Well, I like testimony.
Yes, ma'am. They do help. Last Thursday, I believe, was when you prayed for me. And I experienced just a great relief in the area that I had been struggling in with that spirit husband. And I'd been through deliverance before, but that sensation that, you know, when I've gone through prayer with you was just totally liberating. But it was just so amazing because, and it just showed to me, revealed to me how relentless Satan is in his attacks upon us. Because shortly after you prayed for me, and I sent you a message on Facebook about it, so I don't know if you recall, but shortly after you prayed for me, Satan sent a trick my way, and not having my guard up, I didn't fall for it, or didn't, I don't want to say completely fell for it, but I was not on guard as I should have been. And I've noticed that throughout my life, the cycle of, you know, successful deliverance or, you know, blessings from God or just greatness from God is usually followed by some type of attack by Satan, some type of retaliation. And 9 times out of 10, I'm prepared. But after you had prayed for me to cast out that activity of that spirit husband, a former male friend of mine, boss of mine, called and contacted me and asked me out for lunch and the whole nine, and not thinking anything of it, I accepted. But it was amazing because after I'd gotten off the phone from talking to them, the Holy Spirit was like, you cannot do this. You cannot.
That's
and
right.
it was revelation to me and understanding that was going to be a gateway or a door for this thing to come back in. But once I had prayed with you and I renounced that, and, you know, I have some possessions of his that, because I used to work for him, I have some possessions of his. The Holy Spirit was like, you have to return that. So I'm sending those things back. Yes, ma'am. I'm putting them in a FedEx box and sending them back. Because part of me going to meet them was to, because I'd left the job. He was a former boss, and I'd left the job and was not able to turn in my stuff. And he never pressured me about it because we'd just been friends for so long. He knew I wasn't a thief or anything like that. But part of the purpose of going to meet was to return those items. But the Holy Spirit was like, you have to put them in a box and send them back. So I don't have any problem doing that.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is that as a result of the deliverance on Thursday and just really trying to be obedient to, you know, the voice of the Holy Spirit, I've seen some significant change in my husband just within those past 2 days. Evangelist, he's back in the bedroom.
Back in that bedroom.
He had been out of that bedroom, yes, ma'am. And he would come, but he would only come when I say, you know what, just come on upstairs and sleep upstairs tonight. I'd stopped asking weeks ago. I just stopped asking, but he still would not come back in that bedroom. But now it's consistent. He's always back in that bedroom. He's back in that bedroom. He has been, his tone towards me, his conversation towards me, has just, I'm talking about ever since Thursday, since you prayed, has changed. Whereas before, Satan was using those opportunities, like you said, that spirit wife would be pulling his strings and manipulating him to say and do things to me. And I was became conscious of that. And Thursday and Friday was just a test, you know, and I began to identify, so, okay, this is that spirit trying to rise up, so let me just go ahead and address her by going into prayer in my secret place. I didn't say anything. I kept my mouth shut. I commanded her to leave my husband alone, that he is a blood-bought believer of God, that she has no authority to speak to him. And, I mean, just his tone and his conversation has changed. And, of course, there have been things where, you know, he's constantly on his phone, constantly receiving text messages and constantly on that phone. And that thing tried to rise up in me to go and address this with him. You need to get off that phone when I'm with you. I didn't say one word.
That's right.
And identifying the significant change in his conversation Mm-hmm. Just within the past several days has been amazing. I mean, I am so grateful to God and grateful to you, His vessel, because this has been a phenomenal deliverance to me. I've known my best friend, who's Nigerian, she recently passed away a couple of days ago, but she's been my mentor. She's strong in deliverance, and I'm at peace with that because she was, she's a very good friend. But just the sensation of the level of deliverance that I received last week was just absolutely amazing. It was amazing.
Wow, that's awesome.
God. I have to thank God, and I do want to make sure that I'm totally cleansed. I hope that I do not open up any doors or any entry points or access points for that thing to come back in, because I just, I'm just grateful to God.
Amen. Greater things come. You just continue to see Jesus Christ in you, because Jesus in you is drawing him to Jesus Christ. And after a while, the Holy Spirit is going to open that door where you can minister to him or give him your testimony of how God set you free and from what, and then the Holy Spirit going to convict him, and he's going to say, I want to call that lady.
Amen.
And he's going to get his total freedom. Praise the name of the Lord. That's great. That is good news. You know, as you were talking, I was trying to remember, Lord, who is she? Who is D? Because I ministered to several D's. I thought you was a D from this other woman whose name is Dee. I said, no, that's not her. And I kept on listening, and I was like, oh, I know this Pastor Dee. If you said
Pastor Dee,
I would have
Ma'am.
So I said, let me change her name on this call ID to say Pastor Dee. Then I know
Is
from now
on. Praise God. Glory to God. You're an asset to the kingdom. I'm telling you, it's just amazing because I just can't express enough how much liberation just within, it hasn't even been a week, but if more leaders and more pastors would go through the deliverance, we wouldn't be preaching such toxic sermons and toxic messages to the congregation, and the body of Christ would experience just such liberation. It is so needed.
Yes. So everybody be getting together and coming to church just to glorify and worship God.
Yes, ma'am.
And you're talking about the Holy Ghost explosion in that church, and the devil will come in that church. That devil happens to go.
Because
of the nuclear explosion of God's children.
Yes, ma'am. I mean, we even witnessed, they don't, but we even witnessed it on this past Sunday. We have a lot of worship service out, and we do worship service out on the street. We have a building, but, you know, we go out. God has just called us to be a church out on the street with no walls. So we have open-air ministry, and we had a service out on the street this past Sunday. And just because of the deliverance that the leadership, myself, me, experienced, the worship experience just went. We've always had a very anointed worship service. God has just favored us in that area. But this past Sunday was absolutely just amazing, just absolutely amazing. So, I'm
glad.
I am so thankful. I am grateful
to
God. He's so gracious and so merciful.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank
so
you,
merciful.
Lord. Yes, Lord. He's raising up his vessels.
Yes, thank you, God, for it.
Pastor D, thank you for calling in with that testimony, because it's good to hear testimonies.
Yes, ma'am.
Lift my spirit, encourage me even more to continue to go forth. I love it.
Yes, ma'am. And I try to stay on, though. Forgive me for hanging up. I'm not being rude.
That's okay. I understand.
I'm trying to be a good steward over my job. So I try to hang on. I try to take my lunch break late on Monday, Tuesdays, and Thursdays. When I know you're going to be on, I try to take my lunch break late. And sometimes it doesn't work out like that, but it's
that's
not being
fine. God understands, and I understand too. Okay.
Amen.
Stay
God bless you
now.
Thank you. You as well. God bless you.
You too. Bye bye. Praise God. That was a blessing. Okay, I'm gonna bring on Diana. That's what your caller ID says. So I'm gonna unmute. Okay, is that your name, Diana?
Yes, ma'am. It is.
Okay. Okay, where are you calling from, the state or the country?
I'm here in the United States. I'm in Detroit, Michigan.
Okay, you're in Michigan. Okay, now how you found out about me, Diana?
Actually, I spoke with you about 6 weeks ago in regards to some things that were transpiring in my marriage. We became Facebook friends today, as a matter of fact. I just wanted to try to go ahead and give you a call today because of some of the things that have transpired here in the last 2 weeks. I wish that this could have been a testimony call. I do greatly thank you for the deliverance that I went through 6 weeks ago, which was in regards to my spirit husband. I was also later revealed.
Do a correction, Diane. You never, and that includes everybody, claims spirit spouses as your husband, your wife. You said, my spirit husband, that's possessive. It belongs to me. Okay. It don't belong to you. Never again. Never, ever, okay. ever.
Okay, forgive me, Father God.
That is so not true. So not true.
Because if you
keep saying, my spirit husband, you get some attention. She said, I belong to her. And that thing will jump right back into you because mine is possessive. Just like with people say, my demons. They are not your demons. They don't belong to you. They shouldn't be in you. You know, you never claim them.
Amen.
Okay,
go ahead.
I agree. That really makes me so angry. I hear people say, mine. That's a lie, devil.
Let me rephrase that then. The spirit husband that had caused so much havoc in my life. Mm-hmm. Later on that day, I had actually been revealed the Jezebel spirit as well. And all in the same hour, pretty much, that you and I had spoke. And I rebuked those spirits in Jesus' holy, wonderful name. And instantaneously, from sicknesses that I had felt in my tummy for over 4 years, even upon changing my diets and, you know, drinking more water, cutting my sugar out, all those things, I could never rid and feel as if, you know, I was okay. It had become accustomed to me as well. And instantaneously, I felt better.
Mm-hmm.
That weekend, my husband and I, we went to the river and we had wrote some things down and we cast those spirits out one by one in Jesus' holy, wonderful name.
Hold it, Diana. Why did you and your husband go to the river to do that?
Where
did you two get that idea?
Okay, so here's what it is. It's not necessarily that it originated from anything. I live in Detroit near Belle Isle. Which is a small island off of Michigan that I tend to go to in my time of just to get away. I enjoy the water. I enjoy the outdoors. I enjoy the serenity that's there. And so we went there as a more of a comforting place for me. And so it's nothing in particular. So we went to the river to do it. We know we can do it right in, you know, the four walls of our home. But that's just what we did.
And, you never do that again. That never ever. Because that's not originated from God. Going to the river, you write down things, promises, and you throw it in the river. No. You know when you two threw them promises in the river, do you know who actually caught those promises? Those marine spirits. They grabbed that paper and took it down, deep down into the water to their kingdom. And they read them, and they make sure that it's the opposite of what you think is going to happen.
So we didn't release the actual papers.
It don't matter. It don't matter.
Okay.
Even though you did not release the physical paper, but spiritually, with the paper that it was written on, the spirit paper, whatever we do in this natural realm is only evidence of what is happening in that spirit realm.
Okay.
No. Never again. Go to the waters. Ever.
Okay.
Never. Marine demons, that's their hiding place. That's where they live. You and your husband could just very well, you know, sit there on the coast and then first of all invite the Lord Jesus into your conversation, to your affair. And then you ask him, you present to him your petition, your promises to one another.
Okay.
And when you present to him, then he receives it. But if you bypass him, and in your mind, you cast those promises into the waters, again, those marine demons in the spirit realm have grabbed those requests. And they're going to bring forth the opposite.
So then let me rephrase. I'm not necessarily sure now that I'm thinking back if it was released them into the river. We just went to the Belle Isle River, the Detroit River.
That's what I'm saying.
We left our home.
in the physical realm.
So even if
realm,
we release them in our home.
Again, you cannot bypass Jesus. You know, I love my husband. You know, mm-hmm. I made promises to God, to my husband, but it's only through Jesus Christ. But if I omit Jesus and go to my husband and say, I make this promise to you, Jesus is not in that picture.
We didn't do it to each other. We wrote down things that we felt we were being attacked by, and we did pray before we began to specifically speak these spirits out of our holy temple, back to the pits of hell where they came from in Jesus' name. That was it. It wasn't a promise to him. It wasn't a promise to me. It was actually giving Christ our marriage versus us trying to focus on ourselves or each other, if you will. It was more so
now,
allowing
now,
God.
Now, have your husband ever gone through a deliverance? See, also what I'm finding is Satan's very subtle in his trap, because you've got people who think that they can do self-deliverance. They don't understand what self-deliverance is. They think self-deliverance is the casting out of demons. They can cast demons out of themselves. And you making, because of some of the habits that you may have, and those habits are the ones that cause demons to attach themselves to you, where in order to get rid of those demons, you get rid of those demons by stopping those habits. But when it's the strong man, you cannot catch that strong man out of you. That's why you're going to need a help. But I'm noticing a lot of people, because they're not willing to give up their reputation, Satan get them to think, well, I'm just gonna say this deliverance prayer. I'm just gonna renounce all of this and just release myself from all of these covenants and things, and I'll be totally free. No, you will not, because that strong man is still there. You need help. Just like in the natural realm, thieves come into your house and they bind you up. Now there's some careless thieves that you can unloose yourself, but that thief that is very wise and a professional thief, let them bind you. I don't care what you do, you cannot lose yourself. That's why you're going to need someone else to help you. But that's how it is with the strong man. Your husband needs to be delivered. He needs to be delivered from that strong man, from that spirit wife in him. He should be willing to confess to his own wrongdoings. There's some things that he has not even confessed to you about. You don't know nothing about it. But the Lord has convicted him of this thing, and he's keeping it to himself. He's keeping it to himself. He's refusing to confess it one with another. That means with a true child of God. Because it's the only way God can forgive us is when we confess to our wrongdoings. When he do that, then he can be set free from that spirit that is actually troubling him. Mm-hmm, the spirit that is troubling him is troubling him. So
right.
This spirit makes him...
No, I was going to say, when we spoke Thursday, you and I, on Friday, I had asked the Lord a few things to do. Those things came to pass. My husband and I spoke, because all that week we hadn't really spoke. When we spoke, he was writing down my wrongdoings, if you will.
Yeah.
And I prayed to God about how is it that my husband can do all these things when I know he has some things as well that he needs to address. On that Saturday morning, when I woke up, he had the same pad of paper in front of him, and he had his whole spirit, even the way he sounded, was completely different. It was more peaceful, and he apologized to me, and he said, I'm sorry for pointing the finger at you about the things that you may have attached to you when I have these things attached to me. And he revealed some things to me that, as you said, he was keeping secret, and that was the whole reason why we left, because I didn't want to stay in this house. I didn't want to be here any longer. I was actually, I had pretty much filed for a divorce. All these things have transpired. I know I probably don't have all the time to go through all of those things, but
no, you don't
we
have
left
to
because we left to go because I needed to get out of the house. That's why we went to the river, because that's where I go. And I sit in peace, and I pray to God, and I just enjoy the outdoors. So we went there because I had to get away from our home. I had to get away from the information that he had revealed to me and just go somewhere else. So we went together. I actually wanted to go alone, but my husband wouldn't allow me, indicating that we've made such a mess of our marriage, so we need to come to God together and get our marriage back from the enemy's stronghold.
So was that his word, Diana? He kept saying, we need to get our act together.
He said that, yes.
Yeah. See, he still is not confessing to his own wrongdoing. He's still not doing it. He still is saying, because of maybe the things that you've done and said, this is the reason why I come like this, or why I'm experiencing this. See, he needs to, deep down in his heart, he needs to confess of his wrongdoing, not focus on yours, period. Yours between
right.
you and God. But until he's
Absolutely.
Willing to, until he is willing to confess to his own, then he cannot be delivered. And that spirit wife always bringing up to his attention the things that you've done wrong, things that you're doing. It's because of what we did. Only way he'll confess is he always include you. We. No, when you actually become godless sorrow in your heart, you're only thinking about how you have hurt God, and you will repent to God for the things that you have done, no matter what someone else may have done in your life to make you do those things. You don't think that way. You don't think that way. So now, if you listen to Pastor D, her testimony, see, we as women of God, and who happens to be a wife, who have a physical husband in this realm, you know, it's really our responsibility to live the life of God in our actions, in our reaction, regardless of what our spouse do, regardless how they agitate us. We got to learn to keep our focus on what. And I'm telling you from experience, I've been married going on 32 years, and all those 32 years have not been glorious. And to be honest, it has not been glorious, but I have learned to keep my mind, my affection staying on the Lord. And whenever the enemy tried to raise up through my husband to get me off course, I continue to keep my focus on him. And also, I would hear the voice of God tell me, do not write a letter of divorcement. You don't initiate it.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord tell us women who are women of God and who happen to be a wife, you do not initiate a divorce. You stay there. You stay there, and you continue to trust the Lord that he works in your actions, in your reactions. You have to keep your focus stayed on him.
Amen. And I'm having a hard time doing that as of 2 weeks ago now.
No,
I'm having
you have no hard time because you're taking your eyes off the Lord onto that circumstance. You must keep your eyes focused on the Lord, regardless of the circumstance. And I'm telling you again from experience, Deanna, you have to keep your eyes focused on the Lord. If it means you closing your eyes right where you are and just humming the things of God, just thinking and meditating over the things of God. You don't have to go down to that river. You can stay right there at your house, in your room, right where you are, in your living room, and your mind is just focused on him. You just praise him. You're thinking of his goodness. He's done goodness in your life, so you think of his goodness. And that's what you do. And as you do that, then you will find that strength in your heart, and you'll find that peace. See, God wants to raise us up, Deanna, to the point that we can be sitting right in the midst of turmoil, confusion, loud banging noises, but yet and still there's peace on the inside of us. And when there's peace on the inside of us, we're sitting in the midst of all that turmoil and confusion with a great big smile on our face, because a great big smile is in our heart. That's where God wants to raise us up. You know, there have been times in my marriage where that spirit act through my husband, and it be acting terribly, be calling me, you know, actually, I'm not saying profanity, but every word is other than a child of God, and I'm sitting there. Craig Nash, I love him, and it hurts. But I learned not to focus on that hurt. I still focus on the Lord. And I be thinking of the Lord, and then that spirit say, are you ignoring me? And I still would not say a word. I just still be worshiping the Lord, focusing on the Lord. Then after a while, that spirit get tired, and it goes away. I refuse to give in to the devil. So you got to refuse to give in to the devil. Regardless of who the devil is working through, your parents, your spouse, your children, your other relatives, your employee, it don't matter. I refuse to give in to the devil. And you got to refuse to give in to the devil.
But I feel so overwhelmed. It's like it's just so much. I know
that
I want to be
said, I will not put on you no more than you can bear. That will come to me many times. He will not put on you no more than you can bear. Whatever is happening to you, God's saying you can bear it. But you're going to have to keep your focus stayed on him. Again, I'm telling you from experience. I'm not just telling you based on knowledge only. I'm telling you based on knowledge coupled with experience. Mm-hmm. See, that's the reason that God allowed us to go through certain things in life, because if I hadn't gone through certain things in life, in my marriage, then I wouldn't be able to help the men and women who are going through those same things that I went through in my marriage. I wouldn't be able to help them. But because I know and because I have experience, I can tell you,
mm-hmm.
you must keep your focus on the Lord, because if not, Dee, your mind will end up mental. Your mind
and I feel like that's where I'm
mental.
At.
You're not
I wanna,
You're
wanna,
not there.
I want to speak about my husband and his shortcomings, if you will, but I'm trying to figure out what's wrong with me.
Right. There's nothing wrong with you. What's right about you? Because Satan have lost you, and he wants you back. And he knows that you love your husband, so he's going to work in through the one that you love. That's why the Lord tells us we cannot put nobody over him. Nobody. Not even our children. Because if it's going to come a time when your children get a certain age, you won't, that's going to be another hump that you have to learn how to cross over, another hurdle that you're going to have to jump over.
Mm-hmm.
I don't experience that, too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't experience
mm-hmm.
that, too. But right now, it's just your husband, okay? So Satan, he works through the ones that we love so that he can get us back. And that's why we must continue to keep
like
our eyes focused on the Lord.
I don't feel like
oh,
he's
yeah.
working for my husband. I think it's me. My husband, I wasn't even trying to bring anything up about my husband today. I was merely calling for my fear, my doubts, my worries, my
Yeah, that's what you were calling
anger.
For. That's what you were calling.
but we plan and he plan.
Right. See, we got to realize, you know, we always say maybe our problem lies here or lies there. But when you get talking to God's servant, God may take you in a totally different direction, totally different direction, because he knows. So again, now what I heard the Lord tell you, Diana, do not write that letter of divorcement. Do not agree. Don't. I remember when I first was going through with my husband, and my husband would come all the time, talking about, I want a divorce. I want a divorce. I mean, he was just, it was that spirit of him just constantly kept saying, this was many, many years ago, you don't do that now.
Mm-hmm.
And there have been many times I would attempt to say, okay, but the Lord wouldn't let me. And then one day he said, Tara, he said, never, ever agree with the D word.
Mm-hmm.
That's divorce. He said, the day that you come into agreement with it, your marriage will dissolve. So since the Lord told me that, it didn't matter how many times my husband kept saying divorce, divorce, I would not agree. I had never said it and would not say it. Because the day that you say it, that's the agreement that Satan needs to bring that thing to pass. And like I said, the Lord keep bringing to my heart, he said his word that he's told the wives not to separate from your husband. No. No. You have to trust the Lord. Continue to live for him and to trust him. And he will turn that situation around. You know, and if he don't turn around where maybe the husband will stay, because sometimes husbands do leave, then we're still supposed to trust him. Just trust him. Trust him. And so, D, Diana, what God wants you to do, you have to keep your mind stayed on him. Remember, he will put no more on you than you can bear. If it's happening to you, then you can bear it. But the only way you can bear it, you have to keep your mind and your eyes fixed and locked and stayed on Jesus Christ. Fixed, locked, and stayed on Jesus Christ.
I feel like I struggle in that area. I can't focus to read word. I can't seem to, I'm trying to set aside the time. I'm trying to, and I feel
it's
like I'm pulling from other people more so than, you know, my own knowledge.
It's a battle. I've been there. It's a battle. But you have to keep on. Keep on keeping on. No matter. I've been there. Okay. I was in a spiritual coma for 10 years. This was a spiritual coma. I wasn't in a physical coma, but I was in a coma where I gave up on God, gave up on everything. Just tired of it all, just gave up. And that was the worst thing I could have ever done. Did not realize that when I did that, put me in that spiritual coma. And I did not realize I was in that spiritual coma until I woke up 10 years later. It's like I just woke up. I mean, my body's going about, you know, every day. When you looked at me, I was going to church, you would have thought everything was fine, because that's the persona that I showed. But I did not know I was in that spiritual coma until that day I woke up. And I was standing up in my living room when I woke up, and I kid you not, I shook my head and said, man, I just woke up. Just like, you know, when you're in a physical sleep and you wake up. Well, that's what I felt when I spiritually woke up. And I said, I was asleep. I was in that room by myself. I said, I was asleep. And I literally cried, said, Lord, thank you, because I did not know I was in a spiritual coma. And I said, devil, I'm awoke now, and you are in trouble. But then I know from that point on, it was a battle. It was a struggle just to read the Bible. You know, I couldn't form my thoughts. I couldn't comprehend like I used to, because I've been in that spiritual coma. But I was determined. I was determined to succeed. And I did everything. You know, I had my children were grown. They still were little, still in school. So what I would do, because I need to hear the word in my mind so it can build faith in my heart. I need to keep the word in my mind. So I took and bought me some iPod and put teachings of God's word on it. And I would keep it in my ears day and night, even while I was asleep, because I needed the word to go deep down in my hearing while I was asleep. Because it was a battle. It just was a fight. It was a battle. Because of being in that spiritual coma. And that thing went on for years. I kid you not, it went on for years. I had to continue to do it for years and years. But the point of it, Diana, I was determined. Because if I didn't do it, Satan would have snatched my mind. I would have went mental. And so that's what you have to do. You know, you've got little kids or and you're at home. You know, you can have, like when I would be at work, I would have one earplug in my ear and the other one out so I can hear my environment. Same thing when I was home. I kept one earplug in, the other out so I could communicate with my children, with my family. But all the while, I'm talking to them, the word of God was going into my hearing. And that's what you have to do. That's what you have to do. Because it's a battle. It's a battle. It's a battle. Again, the Lord said he'll put no more on you than you can bear. But you got something to do. See, we have a cross. We are Christ's disciples. And just like Jesus had a cross, we as his disciples, we have a cross to bear. Mm-hmm. It's a point of bearing our cross with Jesus Christ. You know, we want to always have this good feeling all the time. We want to always rejoice in God's blessings. But what about his suffering? Because we too got to participate in his suffering just like we participate in his blessing. But when we start participating in his suffering, That's when we say, well, I can't bear it. I can't stand it. I don't know how long I can take this. I can't take this. No, yes, mm-hmm. you can. Jesus took it. And because of his strength, we can take it too. Mm-hmm. So it's your cross. It's my cross. It's Pastor D's cross. It's everybody's cross who is a true believer in Jesus Christ. We must bear our own cross and follow mm-hmm. him. He said, pick up your cross and follow me. It's your cross. Mm-hmm. The Lord said, you pick it up and you bear it and follow him. Continue to follow him. And no more say, I can't take it. No, you say, I can do all things because Jesus Christ gives me the strength to do it. I can. I can. You let the devil hear you say, I can because of Christ Jesus. Endure and bear all things. I can. Let it come out your mouth. We need to learn to open our mouth and speak God's word so the devil can hear. I can. The devil keeps telling you, you can't, you can't, you can't. And then you repeat it. I can't, I can't. And the devil makes you say it, and you hear yourself say it, then whatever you hear is what you're going to build your faith in.
Oh,
so your faith is being built in, I can't, I can't. No, I can. I can because of Christ Jesus who gives me the strength. I can. Let yourself hear you say, I can because of Jesus Christ who gives me the strength to bear. I can. When the devil say you can't, you say, I can, I can. Your husband, why are you saying I can't? You say, because I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You're talking to the devil. You need to let the devil hear that. Mm-hmm. I can. That's what I do. I can, I can. Praise his holy name. You can. Amen. And that's what you continue to do and continue to say. Okay. Remember, we all must pick up our cross and follow him because we do have a cross to bear. You know, I'm gonna bring a teaching on that on the Holy Ghost Fire Talk Radio. If not Friday, sometime next week on Monday, Friday, and bring a teaching on that. Instead of saying a disciple cross, Lord, they say the believer's cross. I say disciple's cross. People are automatically only going to think about the 12 disciples. But I'm talking about the believer, the believer's cross. Even though believers, we are a disciple, a follower, learner of Jesus Christ, but I have to say the believer, so the person will know that I'm talking about your cross and my cross. We are all disciples of Jesus Christ. We have a cross to bear. Okay? So you're fine.
Okay.
You're fine. You are. You are. You just have to tell yourself that, the Lord said. You have to tell yourself that I can. I can do all things, not some things, but all things, because it's Jesus who gives me his strength to do so. I can. I can.
Okay.
I can.
Do.
You know, when the battle is raging in the house, you just say, I can. Close your eyes, say, I can, I can, I can. Because you stand it first and foremost to build faith in God in your heart and also for the devil to hear those words. Because when you keep saying, I can, in your heart, you know you can through Christ Jesus, the devil is backing away, and then he's running. He's running.
Mm-hmm. And I feel like because I keep trying to worship all the time. I keep the music on. I'm reading more books. I've even asked God to help me to read more so that I can dig a little deeper into the Bible than just a verse here or a verse there.
And
build that up. But I keep feeling like I'm coming up short. And at the end of the day, or even the beginning of the day, I'm exhausted.
Of course you are. First of all, Read the written word, your Bible. Don't read those books. I thank God. I just thank God for how he raised me up. Thank God, first of all, that when the internet first came out, we didn't think it was all important. I'm glad we did think that way, because that way my eyes always stayed in his Bible, in his word, the handheld word, you know. It won't end in on the internet. It won't end a lot of books, but it was in the word of God. So, so that's what you need to do. Just stick to the handheld Bible, your Bible, not no electronic Bible, but the Bible. The Bible. You know, when I say handheld, the one that you hold in your hand and flip the pages.
Yes, ma'am.
Stay in, you use that at all times. Use that at all times just to pick a scripture. Just pick a scripture. And what I used to do when I first started studying reading, I didn't know what to study and read. I would open the Bible. I said, now when I open this Bible and I look at the first verse, that's what I'm going to meditate on, and that's what I did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I trained myself. I had to have to train yourself, and that's what I did. And then the Holy Spirit's so good. I remember he first took me to the book of John, the first chapter. He took me there, and he introduced me. That's when he introduced me to Jesus. And I read it. I read John. And then after that, he took me back to Genesis. And that's when I started to Genesis and read on. And I got so much understanding from that. But the most important thing is, you know, you keep your eyes in the Bible. You know, you have to train yourself. You know, you read, you know, something come up, you know, you leave the Bible there, and every chance you get, you go back. That's what you have to do. Just stay away from all those books.
Okay.
Because it'll bring confusion. Okay?
Okay, thank you so much.
All right, Sister Diana. Now, God's going to give you opportunity after a while where you can share with your husband regarding what he's done for you and setting you free. And that way, when you do that, God's going to convict him that he needs to be delivered, because that spirit wife is still there. And I know about the Holy Spirit that is still there. It's still deep down in him. There's still some things that he still haven't even told you about. And actually, he don't have to tell you about. Just like some things you don't have to tell him about. Mm-hmm. Okay?
But I had a dream. Now, last night I had a dream that we were sitting at a table, and two women came in between us. And I said to him in the dream, God, we just keep getting further and further apart. Like, I got up, came back. Well, first we were sitting together. Someone came and sat in between us. And then I got up, came back. There was another person in between us. Then when I got up from the table and came back again, he was actually, it was I want to say a man had kissed him on the lips.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, where is this even coming from? I very seldom even remember my dream. What is this? Mm-hmm. What is all
it's
this confusion?
It's those spirits. He again needs to be delivered, and God's going to give you an opportunity to minister your testimony to him, and then he'll be able to make his choice on whether he wants God to deliver him or not. And when he make that choice, then you can give him the deliverance conference line number, because he actually need to be delivered from those are sexual demons. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Stay blessed.
All right,
now.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You as well. I'll be praying for you and your ministry as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Praise God. Praise God. All right. I see the next person. I see Paulette. Okay, let me unmute you, Paulette. How you doing, Paulette?
I am good. I called you about, I think it's in August. I'm not quite sure.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to give God thanks. You prayed, and I am completely delivered from spirit of husband and set free. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Again, I love to hear those testimonies. That feels good when they call back with such testimony.
But I have a little problem now.
Uh-huh.
I think I still need deliverance, not from spirit of husband. Sometimes my eyes roll over. And in my spiritual life, I just can't go further than where I am. And also in my physical life, it's like when you have, there's a force, or even in my eyes, there's a force when I look on men in a lustful way. And it's not really me doing it. It's like something controlling my eyes.
Get up and cough, okay? All right, yeah. She hung up and she's going to call back.
Okay.
She's still online. That was Pastor D that hung up. Paulette?
Yeah, I'm hearing you, yeah.
Okay, all right. Now, you sound really low.
Oh, the phone. Let me change the phone. The other phone wants to charge.
Okay.
I'm not using this one. Let me change the phone. Just a minute. Yeah. Is the phone better now?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a little bad.
Yeah, what I'm saying, my eyes, you know, have a thing of rolling over. And most of the time when I'm praying, or you know, when somebody manifests and your eye roll over, that's what happened. I notice what's happening. And when I look at men, I look, I've like, there's a force in my eyes looking at men in a lustful way. And it's not really me of myself doing it. And it makes me feel dirty. And you know, and feel a
okay. Okay, let me see. Let me see if I can understand. Did you say your eyes roll over?
Yeah.
It's like your eyes is rolling.
No, it's like when, just like when I don't know how to explain it. My eyes just roll over, but you come back to normal. Even more than when I, like when you're praying. So I do understand. Sometimes in my tummy, I feel like, you know, when you're praying and have a baby and that baby sees out sometimes. That's all in my tummy feel. So I was wondering if it's the hole in my belly, I don't know, or is the anointing in my belly, I don't know.
No. The devil deceived people with that. Some reason now, spirit snake entered back into you, Paulette.
Yeah.
That spirit snake. And we're going to trust the Lord that he revealed to us. How did it enter back? What was the door? Now, Paulette, do you still wear false hair?
Yes, I still have the false hair. Yes.
Yeah, that's what I did. You still got the false hair. See, that false hair, especially when God had brought you into the knowledge of it, okay?
Yes.
When God brings you the knowledge of it, you know, and you still disobey him, that actually is a great legal ground for the enemy to attach themselves to you because your eyes are wide open to this truth. And you knowing the truth, but you are rejecting God.
Yeah.
So that's how that spirit snake is entered back into you. You have to give Satan back his property. That is his property.
Okay.
And so now, how do you react when you out and you see men? How do your eyes react?
It's like there's a force in my eyes, and I look on men in a lustful manner.
That's snake. That's what's called snake.
Dirty, and I know
it's
not me. Like, there's a force, not really me. Like, a force in my eyes, something controlling my eyes then, not me.
Yeah, that's snake. Snake is spirit love. And again, it entered back into you because of your unwillingness to obey God in that area and getting Satan back his property, which is that false hair. That false hair. Anything false, it's not God. It's not God.
Yeah, okay. And last week, I dreamt. But why I didn't say anything? Because I went on my waking up and in my dream, I saw myself on the ground going like a snake. But
can you say that snake?
I didn't pay any mind because, like, I was sleeping, but I was waking up at the same time. And
mm-hmm.
I was on the ground going like a snake, yes.
But yeah, that's snake.
In my life, I want to move forward, but you know, when there is a blockage or something stopping it from going forward, both in my physical and in my spiritual life.
Yeah, because Satan is hindering. If you give Satan any space in you, he's going to hinder your destiny in the Lord.
Okay.
And snake is there, and eventually, if snake would stay there long enough, it will open the door for a spirit husband to come right back on in, too. And I'm a spirit husband, some other spirits as well. So in other words, you're going to have to give God his property.
Yes.
You have to give God his property. And his false hair is Satan's property. We have to give Satan back his property.
Okay.
Now for those of you who say, well, I don't wear false hair.
Yes.
And that makes you feel good you don't wear false hair. But do you not know coloring your hair? It's still a sin. That's a sin too when you color your hair.
Because
I have a dear sister say, well, what's wrong with combing your hair? It's your hair. And I was just about to give her my answer, but instead God gave me his answer.
Yeah.
And just like I'm talking to you, you know, just when you're talking to someone and someone else interject and start talking to you, but that's how God did me. Before I could give her my answer, the Lord gave me his answer. He said, that's not the color I gave her. It's like saying to me, I could do much better. And when the Lord told me that, I listened to, I typed it out and sent it to the woman because this was on a Facebook post. I said, I never thought about that. That's true, Lord. You color your hair. That's not the color God gave you. And when we change something that God give us, we're telling God, I can do much better. Now, even the scripture tell us that we cannot make our hair gray. And not only gray, it stands for colored.
Yeah.
We can't. You just make the top of it gray or colored, but the root is the color that God has given us. So why are we trying to change that which God have done for us? Are we telling him, I can do much better? That's like telling him, I can do much better. So again, you're going to have to give Satan back his property. And and the glory that God has given you, you must trust him that he will provide, he will beautify it.
Yes, yeah.
You must trust him because if not, those spirits are going to stay attached to you because they're going to be where their property. Now also Paulette, did you change your wardrobe?
No, I didn't.
Okay, you didn't do that either. Now, I forgot now. You are from Africa, is that correct?
Jamaica,
okay. You Jamaican, okay. So in other words, you didn't even change your wardrobe.
No, I didn't.
And what that means is any outfit you got that you put on your body that makes you even feel slightly sexy, you need to get rid of because that spirit snake that suggested that you buy that particular garment to keep you and your look of bound to lust. You see how when you kept it, you see how it kept you bound to lust?
Yes.
See, there's a reason why God gives us these instructions. See, your focus was on getting rid of the spirit husband, getting rid of the spirit husband.
Yeah,
well, the spirit husband did leave, and every spirit that was under spirit husband control, they left too.
Yeah.
But spirit husband knew how to get back into you.
Okay.
He sent snake. Because you refuse to obey God's instruction and getting rid of all those sexy things that you got and also get rid of his hair.
Okay.
Spirit husband knew that was an open door. So told snake, go, enter in. And then once you get in, you open the door for me. And spirit husband's intention was to enter you. Now, spirit husband didn't never enter you yet, but it would have entered you if you hadn't called.
Okay.
But we don't want no spirits that is not of the Holy Spirit in us.
Yes, right, yes. Okay.
So we must be obedient. So obey God. When the Lord, you know, say these things through me, it's not me, dear heart. It's the Lord. I'm learning just like you are learning. I don't know these things, but when God revealed it to me, I'm learning just like you. I'm in awe just like you. I'd be like, wow, Lord. Because God loves us so much, and he wants us to stay free. He just don't want us to be free, but he wants us to stay free.
Yeah.
And we must obey his instruction.
Yeah.
He told us women how to dress modestly, not sexy.
Yeah.
Modestly. The world, really women dress sexy because that's what they focus on the outside. The beauty on the outside, and it's not really beauty, it's disgusting. And God, open your spirit eyes, you see how disgusting that look really is, because you actually see a snake in them. It's just snake.
Yeah.
Men gloating over snakes and don't even know it.
My belly roll over and stiff out sometimes, like when a baby in the belly and stretch out, that's what my belly feels sometimes.
So, Paulette, I'm going to pray for you, and then I'm going to speak another cleansing. Okay, but the Holy Ghost is going to get rid of those spirits in you now, but it's up to you that they stay out of you.
Yes,
you have to
do. Yes, thank you.
Be obedient to God's instructions.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes, okay.
So, Father, in Jesus' name again, thank you for this opportunity to minister your love and grace and mercy to your daughter, Paulette.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
Father, it's your desire that she succeed and be successful in life, in this life. And I thank you for the love and mercy and compassion that you have for her. For it's your desire that she truthfully, spiritually worship you. You don't want anything to disconnect or separate her from you, Father. And I thank you, Father, for giving her another chance. And I thank you for once again freeing her from the voices of the stranger. Father, the doors that the enemy have opened up to her that was not your will, I close those doors in Jesus' name. And doors that the enemy closed, it's your will to be open. I also open every door. I speak peace to Paulette's mind, her will, her emotions, and her body. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen. Amen.
Father, continue to give up more wisdom, more understanding, enlightenment of your
yes.
word, of who she is in your son, Jesus, Jesus is in her. Continue to keep her safe. Don't allow the enemy to destroy her.
Yes,
and give her a desire to be kept. For Father, you are faithful, always faithful to your word. You keep us. And I thank you for what you're about to do once again in her life.
Yes, sir.
So right now, in Jesus' name, I command you, spirit snakes, come to attention. Come to attention in Jesus' name, and I command you to pack all your loads.
Yes.
She had repented. She confessed and repented to the Lord, and that covenant and that contract has been severed. You no more have any legal right to stay. And I command you to loose her. You come out of her mind, her will, her emotions, and you come out of her body in Jesus' mighty name. For the blood of Jesus commands and commanded you to loose her, and to let her go in Jesus' mighty name. Holy Spirit, I call upon you in Jesus' name to search and destroy darkness that is lurking, hiding dormantly in her mind. Burn every spirit in her mind that exalts and lifts itself against the knowledge of God and set them all ablaze. Set them ablaze, Holy Ghost fire. Burn all manner of images and pictures that's been embedded into the conscious and the subconscious of a memory. Burned by your mighty fire, continue to set her mind completely ablaze. Ransack and rinse and wash her mind in and with the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
Holy Ghost fire, even burn and purge in her will. Burn every spirit that is clinging on, hanging on to her will, and that exalts and lifts itself against God's knowledge and her will, and set them all ablaze. Burn, Holy Ghost fire. Ransack her will, baptize and wash and rinse her will in and with the blood of Jesus. Holy Ghost fire, purify even her emotions. Burn every spirit that is hanging on and clinging to her emotions. Burn every spirit that exalts and lifts itself against God's knowledge in her emotions and set them all ablaze in Jesus' name. Purify her emotion by your mighty fire. Wash and rinse and baptize her emotions in and with the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name. Continue to wash her emotions. In Jesus' name. Holy Ghost fire, burn darkness who is lurking, even hiding dormantly in her body. Burn, Holy Spirit, burn every spirit in her body that exalts itself and lifts itself against the knowledge of God and set them all ablaze. Holy Ghost fire, even burn in her eyes. Set her eyes ablaze, Holy Spirit. Burn in front of her eyes, behind her eyes, around the sides. Burn, Holy Ghost, guys, consume her eyes with your mighty fire. Burn every spirit that is hanging on to her eyes. Burn every spirit that exalts itself and lifts itself against the knowledge of God. Burn every spirit that looks out through the window of her eyes and set them all ablaze. Every spirit that's not of you, Holy Spirit, just ransack by your mighty fire. Consume them by your mighty fire. Burn Holy Ghost fire even in her nose, in her nostrils, up and down her throat. Burn Holy Ghost fire even in her ears. Set her ears completely ablaze. Burn Holy Ghost fire even in her belly. Burn Holy Spirit. Just ransack her belly. Burn all manner of spirits in her belly that look like snakes. They're eggs. Look like animals. Look like sea creatures. Insects. Burn Holy Spirit. Just ransack her belly. Her uterus. Her fallopian tube. Her womb. Burn by your mighty fire. Burn up and down her arms and legs, her hands, her feet. Burn on top of her head. Burn any crown, any jewelry that been placed on her head. Set them all ablaze. Burn, burn, Holy Ghost fire. Burn those spirit hands that are clinging to her head. Burn, Holy Spirit. Burn everything that's false on her head. Just set ablaze in Jesus' name. Burn up and down her back, Holy Ghost fire. Burn, Holy Spirit, just continue to ransack her body by your mighty fire in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, in the spirit realm, relationship that was reattached, I disconnect you from her in Jesus' name, for the blood of Jesus disconnect you. The blood of Jesus disconnect you. I disconnect her from every evil relationship. Every relationship the Father did not connect her to, I disconnect her from that evil spirit family. Even in the spirit realm, from that evil spirit husband in the spirit realm, that even that spirit wife, those spirit children, I disconnect her from every relationship that the Father did not connect her to, I disconnect her in Jesus' name. Even in this natural realm relationship the Father did not connect her to, I disconnect in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' name, Paulette, once again, be totally free to serve the Lord in spirit and truth. Be free in your mind. Be free in your will. Be free in your emotion. Be free in your dream. Be free in your vision. Be free in your affairs, in your business, and be totally free in your body to serve the Lord in spirit and truth. Be free in Jesus' mighty name. Father, fill Sister Paulette with your spirit. Fill her will, her mind, her emotion, her dreams, her vision, her affairs, her business, and her body with your spirit, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. And Holy Ghost, once again, I ask you to even ransack her house. Search and destroy darkness who is hoovering and hiding right now. Destroy all their dark hiding places, every corner, crack, and crevice of the house. Destroy darkness that is clinging, hanging on to objects in her house, hanging on to her properties, and its properties. Destroy by your mighty fire, even outside, destroy in Jesus' mighty name. Even in the waters, destroy in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Sister Paulette. Amen. Now, you make sure you obey the Lord's instructions.
Yes, I will. Yes, I will.
Yeah, because if not, these spirits will come back, and this time you won't be so willing to call to be delivered again, because those spirits will convince you that you don't need to be delivered, and that's a dangerous state to ever get in.
Yes.
So you obey the Lord.
Yes, I will.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
You're welcome. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We'll talk again another day.
Yes, thank you, yes.
Amen. Amen to your heart. Praise God. Praise God. Okay, I don't have no other new caller for today, so I'm going to go ahead and end session for today. Now, remember, I hold call-in deliverance sessions every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call our deliverance conference line number 712-775-7031. Enter SS code 335950. And international, just go to our website at howshalom.org/deliverance. And you will find instructions on how to request a session. So, dear heart, stay blessed in Jesus' mighty name.